Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank God. Behold, he comes. Are we ready for the coming of the Lord? Hallelujah. Praise the Lord.
Amen,
hey,
buddy.
Hey. Hey, he's going. As mean as he is, the Lord will have mercy upon him. If the Lord comes, he'll be like, I need one of them little ones up there to cause trouble. Amen. Praise God. Behold, he comes riding in the cloud. Man, I'm struggling trying to keep up with that beat. And I knew in my mind I'm gonna get off beat somewhere and stopped. And so I did. See, I self-prophesied it's going to happen in my mind. And it came to pass. So, but tonight I want to read for our message. I want to read from the book of 1 Samuel, chapter 16, and verses 6 through 12, where God told the prophet Samuel to go and anoint a new king over Israel, because God wasn't happy with the way Saul was living, and Saul was a very self-willed man and very disobedient to the simple commands of the Lord, and so God was going to reject him and his children from being in the royalty and raise up David instead. So he sent Samuel to do that. And that's what his Bible reading is about. In verse 6, it said, and it came to pass when they were come that he looked on Eliab and said, surely the Lord's anointed is before him. But the Lord said unto Samuel, look not on his countenance, or on the height of his stature, because I have refused him. For the Lord seeth not as man seeth, for man looketh on the outward appearance, but the Lord looketh on the heart. Then Jesse called Abinadab and made him pass before Samuel, and he said, neither had the Lord chosen this. Then Jesse made Shammah to pass by, and he said, neither had the Lord chosen this. Again, Jesse made seven of his sons to pass before Samuel. And Samuel said unto Jesse, the Lord hath not chosen these. And Samuel said unto Jesse, are here all thy children? And he said, there remaineth yet the youngest, and behold, he keepeth the sheep. And Samuel said unto Jesse, send and fetch him, for we will not sit down till he come hither. And he sent and brought him in. Now he was a ruddy and withal of a beautiful countenance, and goodly to look to. And the Lord said, arise, anoint him, for this is he. And I want to use verse 7 for a text where he said, but the Lord said unto Samuel, look not on his countenance or on the height of his stature, because I have rejected him. For the Lord seeth not as man seeth. For man looketh on the outward appearance, but the Lord looketh on the heart. And with the help of the Lord tonight, I want to preach just for a little while, since she sang so much. I just want to preach just for a little while in a message entitled, A New Point of View. A New Point of View. Let's look to the Lord in prayer. Marv, would you please pray, sir?
Father, thank you for our pastor. Father, thank you for his soul that present. Father, let us stay focused as pastor ministers your word. Father, let us take his message at heart and do all things pleasing in your sight, giving you the honor and glory. Father, bless the message and the messenger in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen. I mean, I want to preach about a new point of view, and in the sense of us, you know, getting God's point of view instead of our own, and the way we think, we look at things through the eyes of God. You know, if we look at things more through the eyes of God, it'll be a whole lot beautiful, a whole lot better, I should say. If we can just look at things through the eyes of God, if we can look at people through the eyes of God, That will cure all the racism in our world, wouldn't it? You know, because God doesn't care what color a person is. He made us and gave us a color, right? As one brother said, we're all brown, just different shades of brown. Some lighter, some darker, right? But I don't know. I don't know if that's true. Maybe it is. But if we look at things through the eyes of God, what a difference it will make. If we can get God's perspective on things. If we can look at our life through the eyes of the Lord. You know, a lot of times we beat ourselves up for no reason when God is not even beating us up. A lot of times we criticize ourselves when God is not criticizing us. You know, the Bible said the devil is the accuser of the brethren. Yes. Right? He's the one that brings accusation before the throne of God and try to, you know, accuse us of things. He said he accused the believer, the brethren, night and day. Oh, how? You know, and those that accuse other Christians and those that try to fall, I just slipped this in there. Those that try to find fault with other Christians and those that try to destroy other people, they're doing the works of the devil. Yes, absolutely, because the Bible said Satan is, he accusing the brethren, but he's doing it night and day. Some people do that for a living. They're just all day long accusing people, trying to assassinate the character, trying to smear them, trying to bring lies against them, trying to destroy other people from believing and receiving the word of God. And we even had people that used to come to church here to listen to the lies of the devil and stop coming. And they know of a truth that all those things that they were reading and listening were not true, and they still believed it, you know. It's a destroy the souls of innocent people, and that's the work of Satan. It's lies. But if we can see things through the eyes of God, get the point of view and the perspective through the eyes of the Lord, what a blessing it will be. If we can look at ourselves through God's eyes, when God look at us, the Bible said in the Psalm, he said, as far as the east is from the west, so far hath he removed our transgression. As a child of God, if we can look at ourselves and say, you know what? Yes, I may have done some stupid things in my youth, and I've done some things that I wasn't proud of, but God forgave me. It's a different point of view looking at it through the eyes of God. I repented of it. I brought it before God. I put it under the blood of the Lamb, and I am now clean, and God looks at me as being justified in the sight of God. I am not guilty before God. Then why should I view myself and guilt trip my own self if I'm not guilty before Him? Right? Now, if I'm guilty before Him, that's a different story. He will let me know. Right? He will let me know if I'm guilty before Him, or He will let me know if my sin stands, if my sin is separating me from Him. He will definitely let me know if there's something between me and Him. But if there's nothing, then why should I accuse myself of something God already forgave me of? Right? Why should I do the works of Satan trying to destroy myself when God said I'm justified? When God said I'm cleansed? When God said that He took my sins and cast it into a sea of forgetfulness? When God said, when David said, Lord, remember not the sins of my youth. Oh, Lord, God knows we have all done crazy things in our youth. Some of us start really young, and we build up an account really quick before God. But thank God that through the blood of Jesus Christ, all those things have been forgiven. Thank God that He washed away all our sins. He cleansed us. We are a brand new creature. He said, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature, a new creation in God. And so we see things through the eyes of God, a different point of view. And so God is showing us here in our Bible reading, as He was choosing this new king for Israel, this new leader, this man that God will begin to use to bring about the glory of Israel and to establish them as a nation. You know, David was one of the best kings Israel ever had. He did so much for that nation. Yes, Solomon built upon it, but it was David that laid the foundation for all the things. It was God that gave David the blueprint how to build the temple, how to set things in order and all that stuff. It was David that God used. And God was looking at this man, David. He was looking at the heart of this man. You know, God looks at the heart of the people. Sometimes we ask the question, why me, Lord? Why me? There's so many great and wonderful people, but why me? Why did you look upon me? Why did you save me? Well, He will save anybody. That's for sure. He will save anybody. They just have to want to be saved. You just have to want to receive Christ into your life. But a lot of times we belittle ourselves so much and we ask the question, why me? But maybe God saw something in you, but you never saw in yourself. Maybe God saw something in you that you never understood about yourself. You know, he was looking for a king, and the Bible said that, Samuel got to the house, and the firstborn of Jesse came before him. He was tall. He was good looking. Maybe he was strong. He had, on the outward, he had that kingly appearance. On the outward, he looked like he can be the next king of Israel. But there were things in his life that God wasn't pleased about. And we saw it. It came out eventually. Especially when David stepped out to face Goliath and all the evil that he was thinking about his brother. Oh, I know the naughtiness of your heart, David. You are just here because you want to see what's going on and you want to do this and you want to do that. And he was just criticizing a little brother, even though he knew that God had already chosen David to be king. He was there when God anointed David to be king. And the jealousy of his heart and all that stuff was coming to the surface. But you see, God saw that. And God said, I don't want this one. I don't choose this one. I'm looking at this young guy right here. This one that is out there with the sheep. He's a shepherd boy. I've been talking to him and I've been helping him. He was out there when they were all, you know, going, you know, living their own lives. David was out there with the sheep, with his harp, and with God. He was fellowshipping with the Lord. He had a walk with God already. He had, the Bible said he was out there and slaying lion and slaying bear and doing all kind of great things. He was out there on the pastures feeding the sheep, and God was being a blessing to him. And so God saw his heart, and God knew, man, this is a man that I can trust with authority and power. This is the man that I can use for my glory. He said, I found David, the son of Jesse, a man after my own heart. And a lot of times we may not be able to do a whole lot of things, but if we have a heart like God, that's a blessing. Amen. If we have a heart after God, we have a heart that acknowledges God in our life. We have a heart of humility that will say to God, God, whatever you want me to do, I will do it. That's what God values. He values those things that the world looked down upon. You know, the things that, you know, the world love, pride. And then somebody come out there looking all proud and starting to act all arrogant and everything. The world is all behind that. They love that energy. They love that pride. Yeah, you see it in sports and different things. This person come out there and just walking like he's everything, you know. And the crowd just gets behind them because they love pride. They're children of pride. They adore the pride in other people. But you see, with God, I'm talking about a new point of view. God looks at the humblest of the heart. God looks at humility. God looks at someone that will be willing to bow their knees before him. God looks at someone that will say, someone who will be willing to say, Lord, whatever your will is for my life, that's what I want to do, Lord. God is looking for someone like his son, Jesus Christ, whom the Bible said, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God. If you go down to the book of Philippians chapter 2, where I gave you verse 5. That's towards the end of the message, but we'll take it. Whatever, if you guys have it up there, throw it up there. Read it. Philippians chapter 2, verse 5. He's looking for someone like this. He said, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation and took upon him the form of a servant and was made in the likeness of men. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Wherefore God also had highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow of things in heaven and things in earth and things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. That's what God is looking for, a different perspective, a different point of view. The Bible said God doesn't see things the way the world sees things. The world promotes pride and arrogance and this and that, but God is looking for people with a humble heart. God is looking for people whose heart is perfect towards him. I'm not saying that we have no, or weaknesses or anything like that, but I'm talking about a heart that says, Lord, I will become what you want me to be, Lord. Let you be the potter and I will be the clay. That's what God is looking for. He's looking for someone to say, Lord, I am a vessel. Just make me what you want me to be. Shape me, form me. Let me be what you want me to be. And that's what God is looking for, a different perspective, a different point of view. God is looking at the heart. And a lot of times people put themselves down not understanding that God saw something in you that he likes. God saw something in you that he can use. God saw something in you that he wants to capitalize on. And a lot of times we hinder that because we don't see it in ourselves. We don't see what God sees. We're looking on the outside. We're like, in the book of Samuel. Samuel went there and he was a prophet. He was a man of God. No doubt about it. We're not finding fault with Samuel. Samuel was a great man of God. One of the best. One of the best. He served God from a little. He was dedicated to God from a child. His mother took him to the temple. And there he was serving the Lord in the temple. Even when the high priest wasn't doing right and his sons weren't doing right, Samuel was. He was a great man of God. And even he couldn't get past looking on the outside. He went up and he's like, well, this one looked like a king, and that one looked like a king, and God can use this one. But God said no. God said no. God said no. And he brought all the sons of Jesse before him, and God said, no, nope, nope, I don't want any of those. He said, go get that little guy out there. In the I don't know how small he was. go get the youngest one, the one that's out there in the field, and bring him. And as David come, and the Bible says he was beautiful to look upon. He was a handsome young man. And the Lord said, arise and anoint him, for this is the one. This is the one. God saw something in him. And you know, God sees something in all that are willing to believe and trust in him. There's a beautiful thing about Christianity is that God looks at the heart of the individual. And he said, that person, though they may not have the best of wisdom and all that stuff going on in life, yet they have a heart that I can work with. Yet they have a mind that I can work with. You know, the Bible says we have the mind of Christ, right? After we get saved. Yet they have a heart that I can use, because God cannot use pride. The Bible said he resists the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. And so when a person have a humble heart, when a person have a tender heart before God, God can use that individual for his glory. God can glorify himself in that vessel. God can use that vessel. I'm not talking necessarily to preach or whatever, but there are many different uses that God may want to use somebody for. And God was saying, I'm looking at the heart of that person. And because I see something good in that person's heart or the humbleness in that person's heart, I can take that individual and I can use him for my glory. I can put my spirit in that person and it's not going to overwhelm them, and they're not going to get prideful, and they're not going to get arrogant, and they're not going to, you know, think that they are everything and they're this and they're that, but they will stay humble before me, and as they walk humbly before me, I can begin to use them, and I can use them for various things in my kingdom. I can use them to be a blessing. I can use them to bless other people. I can use them. I can give them a word of encouragement. I can do things in their life and through their life, because I'm looking at their heart. Their heart is what I'm looking at. And a lot of times, we are our worst critics sometimes. We forget that God saw something in us, just like he did in David. God saw something in us. And he said, I can use that person. I can use that person. I can use that person for my glory, for my kingdom. And so tonight I'm talking about a different perspective, a different point of view, a new point of view of yourself. Not to look at yourself in a prideful way, but look at yourself as if God chose me, right? if God saved me, then that means he have a purpose for me. He has a will for me. Yeah, I may not be the best. Can't put two words together. Can't put two sentences together. That don't stop people from running for president, though, right? They're going for the highest office. I may not be able to do. I'm looking at myself, and I don't feel sufficient. Well, our sufficiency really is not of ourselves; it's of God. You know, our ability is not of ourselves; it's of God. God is the one that will work through us. And so, look at it. You can come to me and say, "I will keep it small, short tonight." Right? A new point of view, a different point of view. We all have different point of views and things, but if we can get God's perspective on ourselves, God's perspective in our life, God's viewpoint, then we probably won't be as hard on ourselves. We'll probably be like, okay, Lord, I know I'm not the best, but if I can pray and if I can stay humble before God, God can bless me in so many ways. Amen. If I can pray and I can stay humble before the Lord, God can use me just like He did David. And He used David greatly. He put His spirit upon David, and we know all the great things that David did. But it wasn't in David's power that he did it. It was in the power and the spirit of the living God. And so if we can get in our mind that God can help me. God can use me. God can work in me. God can work through me. I just have to stay humble before the Lord. I just have to give myself to prayer and seeking God and keep my vessel to where the Spirit of God can work through me. And you know, that's what God is looking for. So tonight I'm talking about a new point of view, not necessarily on the world and life and all that stuff, but a new point of view on yourself. Understanding that God chose you. We're talking about in the Bible study, right? We're His chosen people. We're part of His family. You know, if we can get that point of view about ourselves, think about what we can do for God. If we can get that point of view that, wait a minute now, I am a Christian. God saw something in me. God saved me. I have Jesus in my life. Then yes, I can be a soul winner for Jesus. Amen. I can be a witness because I'm seeing myself in the right perspective. I can pray for someone and God can help that person. I can do the will of the Lord. I can accomplish what God wants out of my life when you get the right point of view of yourself. Instead of allowing Satan to accuse you and beat you up and place you down and you feel so discouraged and you feel so unworthy and you feel like, man, I can't do anything. Yes, we can. Amen. Yes, we can. We have to look at it the way God sees us. God, look at David. I can use David. The smallest, the least of all the brothers, but I can use him. And that's the way we got to look at ourselves tonight. With that point of view, I may not be a whole lot of my own self and my own abilities and everything, my talents. I may not be able to sing myself out of a wet paper bag, but God can still use me. Amen. God can still help me. God can still do something in my life. And when you get that point of view, that perspective on yourself, that God saved you for a purpose. And you stay humble before the Lord and you pray and say, God, make me a usable vessel. Oh, who knows what God can do in our life? Oh, who knows what God can do in our life? You see, a lot of times we think that we have to be eloquent and we have to have everything down, you know. How many times we try to be eloquent and witnessing to somebody and it doesn't work? And then sometimes we just say, hey man, why don't you come to church with me? And I say, okay, I'll come. You know, because God was there. God was touching. God was helping. Amen? God is working. And so we have to look at it in that perspective, a different point of view, a new point of view. God saved me for a purpose. Amen. God saved me for a purpose. I can be what He wants me to be. I can accomplish what He wants me to accomplish. And I can do what He wants me to do. And so as we bow and close our eyes in reverence to the Lord tonight, the Bible said, man look in the outward, but God looks at the heart. Man look on the outside. Man look at the physical aspects, the attributes of someone, their height, their looks, everything. But God is looking at the heart. How soft is that person's heart? How tender is that person's heart? How receptive is that person's heart? And when he finds a heart that is soft and tender and receptive to him, he will come in and he will begin to manifest his greatness in our life. Father, thank you for the word of God tonight. Thank you for the worship, God, that we can get together and worship you. Tonight, God, we just want to glorify you and honor you and praise you. We thank you for choosing us to be your servants, O God. We thank you, God, for placing your spirit in our life. We thank you, God, for loving us and for calling us for your glory. Father, I want to give you all the glory and honor tonight. I want you, God, to manifest your grace in my life and the life of everyone that will let you tonight. Father, bless and accomplish your will. Let the Spirit of God move, continue us throughout the end of the service, God, and even beyond. Let your Spirit continue to be with us. I ask this now in Jesus' name. Amen. Praise the Lord. She's going to sing. Let's spend some time in prayer. This week, just have a new perspective on yourself, not for pride, but just realize God saved you, God is in you, you're not worthless or useless or anything like that. You're God's child, amen? God's child, and God cares and loves you, and we all have a purpose. And once again, I just want to give glory to God. God's presence is strong in this place again, and I went up to the altar and just boom, he's there. and so I'm sharing this because I want you to know God is honoring his word if you let him. He's honoring his word, and he will continue to do so. So remember our Bible study Tuesday night at 7:30. We're continuing the book of Ephesians. And so have a blessed week. Have the right perspective on yourself, the right point of view on yourself, that God is on your side, God is for you, and God will stand with you as you stand with him. And we'll close the service in prayer. Marvin, would you please close us tonight?
Father, thank you for all you accomplished in this service this evening. Father, keep your hands upon us and bring us back to the next appointed time. In Christ's name, amen.
Amen. Amen.